afternoon. Thank you all for coming. I'm Candy Nelson. I'm a professor in the Department of Government here at AU and the interim director of the Center for Congressional and Presidential Studies. When I came up with the title for this forum, I don't think I realized exactly what we were going to be talking about. But we have a terrific group of AU faculty here to explain what happened, or at least help us understand some of what happened. So I'm going to briefly introduce our panelists. Their complete bios are outside, and they're also on the Congressional and Presidential Studies website, so feel free to go there if you didn't pick one up. So I'm going to start, and we'll proceed in this order with Professor Molly O'Rourke. She's an executive in residence in the School of Communication here at AU, where she also serves, along with myself, as co-director of the MA in Political Communication Program. Molly has more than 15 years experience in the field of public opinion research, most recently as a partner at Peter Hart Research here in DC. Next to Molly is Professor Jan Leighley, also in the Department of Government. Professor Leighley's research and teaching interests include voting behavior, political participation, and the political behavior of African American and Latinos in the United States. Next to Professor Leighley is Professor Eric Hershberg, also a professor in the Department of Government, and the director of the Center for Latin American and Latino Studies here at AU. Professor Hershberg has published widely on issues of political economy, development, and democracy in Latin America. Next is Professor Jennifer Lawless. Professor Lawless is also a professor in the Department of Government here at AU and the director of the Women in Politics Institute. Her research and publications focus on representation, political ambition, and gender in the political process. Next is Professor Betsy Fischer Martin, who is an executive resident in the School of Public Affairs. She's the co-host of Bloomberg Politics Masters in Politics podcast. Prior to coming to AU, Betsy spent many years as a senior executive producer and managing editor of NBC News, political programming, including 13 years at Meet the Press. And last but not least, at the end, is Professor Sam Garrett. Sam is a specialist in American national government at the Congressional Research Service, where he specializes in campaign finance. He is also an adjunct professor in the Department of Government and a research fellow at CCPS. So thank you to all our panelists for coming in after what I'm sure has been a difficult 18 hours, just in terms of trying to analyze everything that's gone on. So Molly, I'm gonna turn over to you.
Great, thank you, Candy. So I think I will start by saying explaining what happened on Tuesday involves explaining why what we thought was going to happen didn't happen on Tuesday. It's not exactly like the Dewey defeats Truman headline from 1948, but people are rightfully asking, in an era of sophisticated data analytics, modeling, some really innovative techniques, how did the polls get things so wrong? And I do want to talk about some of the fundamental assumptions that went into the mistakes that we saw in the polling projections. But first, I just want to make a few technical points about polls, just so that we all have the same understanding moving forward. This is maybe the first little piece is my in defense of polling mantra, but I promise I will get to some of the more core issues that really were problematic in this cycle. So the first thing I just want to say about polls, again, so that everyone has kind of a common understanding, is that really pretty universally everyone got it wrong this year. It was not that the polls were rigged in favor of Clinton. Even the RNC, the Republican National Committee's turnout model and projection model, underestimated Trump's support, and that is, I think, important in sort of understanding the context that this happened. But I also know it's not enough to say, as people have, oh, you know, the polls were wrong, but it was all within the margin of error. That's not really an acceptable answer either, given that the polls were very systematically over-reporting Clinton support and under-reporting Trump support. So when there's that kind of systematic pattern, it's not really attributable to the margin of error. but nor is it really evidence of a conspiracy. I think there's really a lot of rightful kind of soul-searching and scrutiny going on. The final thing I'll say about kind of the technical piece on polling is that polls aren't meant to be predictive. I say this a lot, but polls are meant to be a snapshot of when the poll was taken. In that respect, the Gallup organization, which is a kind of pioneer in the field of public opinion research, actually in 2012 stopped asking the presidential trial heat question because they felt as though it was just impossible to educate poll consumers or poll users that it wasn't meant to be predictive. And so they said, because the information is misused, we're not going to ask it anymore. And indeed, the polls weren't predictive this year. I think some of the evidence suggests that Trump did have momentum in the final week of the campaign. According to the exit polls, 14% of voters made up their minds in the final week. And of that segment of the electorate, they went pretty decisively for Trump by a five-point margin. So none of that was reflected in the polling that came out the weekend before the election. Polls stop usually on Saturday, Sunday before the election. And also it takes 24, 48, sometimes 72 hours for news developments to actually sink in and be registered in public opinion. So whatever the effect of kind of the Comey letter and the final week of the campaign, it is pretty clear that Trump enjoyed some momentum there. Putting that aside and getting into the bigger picture of what happened, there's a couple of key things that, observations. First is that we got the turnout projections wrong. And that's always a challenge, to model who is going to turn out to vote, but it was especially problematic this year. It was the evidence so far suggests it was a very low turnout election. Turnout, so far, estimates are at 55.6%, which would make this the lowest turnout election since 2004. Low turnout elections are always hard to model and to predict because you know, really don't know who's going to come. We do know, based on the exit polls, that there were 7 million fewer Democratic voters in 2016 than there were in 2012. In the exit polls in 2012, party registration or party identification was a 6-point margin in favor of Democrats, and this year in 2016, it was a 4-point margin. So the turnout, the projections of what the electorate was going to look like, was wrong in terms of the overall turnout, but then among some very specific audiences. There's, you know, a lot of discussion over the last 36 hours that the Obama coalition did not come together for Clinton in the way that I think some polls projected that it would, and certainly that the Clinton campaign hoped. The exit polls show right now that 18 to 29-year-olds actually did turn out at the same level as 2012. I'd be surprised if that doesn't get revised. But Clinton did not win them with the margins that Obama won them. Obama won 60% of those millennials. Clinton won 55% of them. In terms of African-American turnout, it was down 1 point overall in the exit polls nationally, which doesn't, maybe 1 point doesn't sound significant, but it is the opposite of the expectation given changing demographics in the country. African-American and Hispanic turnout has been consistently rising over the last, especially in presidential election years. So to see it counter that expectation and go down is notable, but it's also that it went down in some very targeted places. So in North Carolina, African-American turnout was down, depending on how the early vote or the absentee vote, 4 or 5 points. That's really very significant. In Pennsylvania, African-American turnout was down 3 points. So the national numbers kind of mask what was going on in some of the key, in some of the very specific states that ended up being quite decisive. And then I think the other thing, you know, in terms of projecting turnout and getting some of these key audiences wrong, is that the pre-election polling really underestimated the non-college segment of the electorate. In the ABC Washington Post poll that was, and I'm not picking on any particular poll because honestly there's blame to go around, but in that poll the weekend before the election, that poll showed white non-college voters going for Clinton by a 9-point margin, and the exit polls have that segment of the electorate going for Trump by 4 points. That's a really, really significant shift that that I want to, I'll come back and talk about in a minute. The turnout projections were problematic, but also the, as I just alluded to, kind of the prediction about marginal support within particular audiences was also really off. The non-college vote that I just described was significantly off, and the college, the kind of compensating margin among college graduates wasn't as big as the pre-polling indicated that it would be. The national polls, according to the Real Clear Politics average on, I think, Monday before Election Day, had Clinton with a 3-point lead nationally. It'll turn out that she wins the popular vote by maybe less than 1%. So the national numbers don't, that's an important distinction, but it's not that that's so wildly off. Where we really saw the inaccuracies was at the state level, and some specific states, kind of the worst offenders, I looked at the Real Clear Politics average in some states compared to the outcome, and Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania were three states in which the polls really were, the national polling average wasn't that off, but in key states, they were really off. In Michigan, by 4 points, so the Real Clear Politics average had Clinton leading on the Sunday before Election Day by 3.5 points. That's an aggregated number, and yet Trump won the state marginally by about 0.5%. In Wisconsin, the number was off by a very big margin, about 7.5 points between the pre-election polling and the outcome. And so we're left to ask, why did that happen? There's been some discussion about a mode effect in how public opinion is measured or how we record people's opinions. It's sometimes known as the Bradley effect, whether people are willing to tell interviewers who they're voting for in an accurate, systematically accurate way. I think there is some evidence here that there is a mode effect. Trump was consistently doing better in online surveys than he was in phone surveys. So people who are in my research class, I talk about social desirability bias, which is not kind of disclosing accurately who you're voting for. There's some evidence that not enough, I think, to be conclusive yet, but it's certainly something that we need to look at. And then the final point in terms of the key dynamics of the race is that I think this was an especially volatile electorate. The mood of the electorate has been set for a while. They were angry. They wanted change. Voters wanted change. The economy was very important to them. So that was kind of anchoring them, but their feelings toward the candidates really left them very untethered. These were two extremely disliked candidates. Both had double-digit negative unfavorability ratings, Clinton by 10 points, Trump by 22 points. More than 60% of voters in the exit polls said that they didn't trust each of the candidates. And so I think that that left a lot of possibility for fluctuation, and we did see those contradictions in the outcome of the exit polling, where about 20% of Trump voters say they have doubts about his temperament but are still voting for him. And so I think that that the volatility based on their orientation or kind of their perception of the candidates also made this a very difficult election in terms of really assessing voters' moods. And I'll talk, I think, I'll save this for part of the Q&A, but that has really important implications in terms of governing and what the agenda is. There'll be a lot of conversation about whether there's a mandate for Donald Trump or not. I think their evidence suggests here that even if it had been a Clinton victory, there's not a lot of mandate here. This is an election in which voters expressed a lot of contradictions and a lot of skepticism about both candidates.
Thank you, Molly, very much. Jan, we'll let you continue the discussion of turnout.
That was great. Molly just scooped me on all the relevant details on turnout.
Sorry.
So I'll take a step back a little bit to note that this, especially with many students in the audience, this is one of those times where I'm I don't get to say it very often, but it's sort of a relief to occasionally be able to say, I think the political science of this election was actually better than the polling, which in this period in which we are so obsessed on all of the polling and all of the data, we forget that much of that polling and those models are based on literatures and arguments and theories and past performance in elections. And so it was appealing, despite how much fun following the polls used to be, right, and how much pleasure and anticipation can be derived from that, that in essence, I think we can't forget about how individuals are making decisions about whether they vote or not. And of course, as Molly noted, one of the big problems with the polls is having to figure out a model of voter turnout, right? They have to figure out who's likely to show up at the polls. And I believe Anna Greenberg said at the same panel 4 years ago, we simply don't have a decent turnout model, right? And all of the polling that we're getting would be the limited variance that was there, and there was variance, certainly reflects different decisions about who, how to figure out who is responding in surveys is actually going to show up and do and cast a ballot on election day. So anyways, I'm kind of happy about the political science part of it, and in contrast to some of the polling problems, which doesn't mean the polls are worthless, that anyone is at fault, but a great time to kind of reinvestigate the nature of that polling. I would note that in terms of the political science of it, that, you know, we hit, political scientists talk very much about the Michigan model and vote choice, and, you know, we were right on it. Republicans voting at about 89% to 90% for the Republican candidate, despite the entire campaign discussion being how unique a candidate was, Trump was, and about the same percentage of Democrats voting for the Democratic candidate. So, to students in the audience, we've known this for a long time. Despite the changes in technology, in big data, in all of the different ways in which campaigns are elected today, we know that voters are anchored very deeply and consistently according to their partisan identities. And I don't think any of the social media in the world are going to change that, and I don't think the basics of campaign mobilization, they certainly take that into account as well as part of this process. So I was at a panel about 2 weeks ago, and I had the unfortunate experience on the campaign to a group of international students, and I had the unfortunate experience of going first in response to the question, what do you think turnout will be? The other two people on the panel were politicos downtown in pretty high-level positions, having done high-level consulting and polling work and et cetera. And so I was the lone academic who studies voter turnout. I said, I think it'll be about the same. I went through my list of the things that we know based on prior elections about turnout. And I was followed by two gregarious, committed consultants, strategist saying, record high turnout, and I just wanted to climb under the table and thought, well, at least I didn't predict this to my classes. What we know about voter turnout, what I'm basing this on is we have a political scientist, Mike McDonald at the University of Florida, has really the best source on turnout. There's no official ballot or turnout percentage even a few weeks after the election. Nationwide, what McDonald does is collect data in a really clean and good way. His preliminary estimate, because we don't have all those ballots in yet and the numbers cleaned up, is that we had a 55.6% turnout rate this week's election, compared to 58.6 in 2012, 62% in 2008, and 60% in 2004. So the reason, why, right? We were hearing media stories of the anger and the intensity and the mobilization of youth, especially by the Sanders campaign. We had talk of counter-mobilization of Latinos and African Americans in response to some racist comments, I believe, and part of the campaigns or by the supporters. And my view in terms of turnout not being high was that, first of all, we have a very negative attitude toward the candidates. We have one candidate who is not talking about a whole lot of issues beyond building a wall. And no policy specifics. So we can talk about the anger, but most of what we have known up to this election has been when people are angry and in economic distress, they're more likely to be demobilized than mobilized. Now, how this will play out in terms of the relative importance of individuals' economic experiences, that white, middle-educated class, that took sway in this election will be a question we study in the future. But I think what we need to recognize, and perhaps you'll take you'll feel better keeping this in mind, is each election is different. As much as our models are based on past history, what's different in these campaigns are the candidates and the issues at stake. We've woefully missed the disengagement of Republicans and lower education, low income Republicans from their separation from the party to some degree. And I think the feature that we had this time around, why those polls didn't work, why turnout was a little lower, is because in the end that it was hard for some Republicans to show up to vote for Trump, right? But also that we didn't have a typical Republican candidate. I think those candidates are going to change in the next election, right? So one of the things that happens with the polling data and predictions of election is, as we know, it's all about the horse race, and it's all about the game, and it's all about strategy. What if we had had a media coverage, a political conversation that talked about economic distress? I was saying to Candy before the panel today, I have family in a lot of these Midwest states, and I go back every summer. It's pretty amazing the things I learn about the United States when I'm stopping at a truck stop in Springfield, Missouri, right? To see how people are talking and what people are talking about and how they're getting by in some of those communities, or my friends in Ohio about drug issues going on. That is not a part of much conversation at all, certainly I think inside the Beltway for most people, but also in terms of the media coverage and the campaign conversation that about the issues that are facing people. So I'm hopeful that this part of the wake-up call here will be a return to more substantive conversations about the issues facing the American public and citizens, and to have some sort of dialogue along those lines. If people know that there's a choice between candidates, there's a choice in the policies they would offer them were they elected, right? They're more likely to show up to vote. So let me note, in terms of the political science of it, one of the reasons we had estimates of high voter turnout was because we saw all these excited people either at rallies or then in the last 10 days, all of the lines of early voting. Okay. Well, it's not that all politics is local or state level, but there's an awful lot of that. One of the reasons there were lines is that the hours of early voting that were available were cut back. It became a politically charged motivation in many of the locations that Molly referred to. But here's the thing that we know as political scientists. A fair number of people have shown that people who vote early are those who would vote on election day. They just show up to vote early because it's more convenient. So I think part of what we got in this story, and maybe that builds the broader context on which we interpret, either we use the turnout models or interpret the findings, or we see the long lines of people and say, record turnout. But there weren't many lines on election day in a lot of places. And that's because more people decided early because they thought the choices were clear for them, right? And so those numbers didn't come in on election day. And so I think that broader context of what's covered and exciting in the media and those long lines were all about a substitution effect of early voting rather than any enhancing the electorate. who the campaigns try to reach to get to vote are not necessarily new voters, right? The best data they have are on those who turn out, and that's really where the focus is for about 90% of the campaign. Finally, I would add, because this is a challenging issue, that I think is related to voter turnout, but other aspects of the campaign as well. And that is the either overt or covert racial tones of the campaigns in terms of the issues raised, in terms of discussions of policies, in terms of some behavior of either candidates or supporters or opponents, that it's very hard to have those conversations. While the argument has been, and we have some evidence, that what happened in California in the 90s with Pete Wilson in talking about very negatively about immigrants was to mobilize, and threats against racial and ethnic minorities tend to create counter-mobilizations, right? So it isn't just pass the voter ID law or threaten to build a law and you mobilize whites out in certain states or certain whites, but it's also the case that you create a counter-mobilization. In some states where Latinos make up a sufficient proportion of the population, that can be key and an overriding aspect. But we can't remember that for some individuals and various minority groups, there is a rhetoric which tends to emphasize suppression and that they are not members of the electorate or they are not part of our democratic family, if you will. That isn't necessarily going to mobilize. I think that also leads to some demobilization for people who can't be reached by candidates or campaigns or social communities. So with that, and having made reference to some of the things that Eric might talk about, I'll close. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. As Jan said, one of the demographic groups that received a lot of attention in this election were Latinos, so I'm going to turn it over to Eric to speak to that.
Well, thank you, Candy, and thanks to CCPS for putting together this forum, which I think is now really a regular every 4 years, every 2 years. Okay, so, and I think it's a really good opportunity to have a conversation about what we think has happened in just completed elections. I think turnout is really going to be one of the critical discussions for quite a while amongst political scientists, and turnout both of the electorate as a whole and of subgroups within the electorate. And I'm going to focus my remarks on Latinos and the place of Latinos in this election and in the campaign. Going into the election, it was widely supposed that the Latino participation would be up and that the rates of support for the Democratic candidate Clinton would be as high or even higher than they were for Obama in 2012. Obama received around 70, let me just see the exact number. Obama received 71% against Romney's 27% of the Latino vote. And if you look at the projections of pollsters such as Latino Decisions, which is generally considered to be the top operation for assessing Latino political preferences and voting intentions, they predicted that the margins would be even higher, and in that sense that we would see a further consolidation of an important electoral block of Latinos for the Democratic Party, and the perpetuation of the problem that the Republicans faced and that had been the focus of the so-called autopsy put forth by the Republican National Committee after the 2012 election that said that they needed to move on comprehensive immigration reform, they needed to avoid exclusionary rhetoric, they needed to be open to Latinos and so on. They nominated a candidate who did precisely the reverse, and yet it turns out that exit polls suggest that Clinton only got 65% rather than 71% of the Latino vote, and that Trump got 29%, doing better than Romney's 27%. And as a result, the notion that Latinos were going to be a decisive factor in tilting some very close states was for the most part not correct. My sense, and we'll see once people have a chance to dig further through the data, is that the one exception to that may be Nevada, that Clinton won Nevada and the Democrats kept Harry Reid's Senate seat because of high margins and high participation of Latino voters, but it wasn't decisive. The Latino vote wasn't decisive anywhere else. It did reduce the margins of the Republican edge in places like Arizona and Texas, and in that sense confirms that there may very well be a gradual tendency for some states that have been red to become increasingly purple, and that there is a demographic dynamic at play that is going to have long-term implications, but it has not yet proved decisive. So I think that's one thing we can take from the results of the past couple days. I think that, as Jan indicated, there's not evidence that Latino turnout or African-American turnout was swelled by the rhetoric of the Trump campaign. The notion that there would be a response, a reaction to that campaign, to what was widely perceived, and I think appropriately perceived, in African-American and Latino communities as a racist campaign, that didn't translate in people necessarily showing up to vote. Just a parenthesis, I mean, and this goes back to your opening comments. If you look at the decline in African-American participation in Detroit and Milwaukee, that alone can explain what happened in Michigan and Pennsylvania. And that, I think, is one of the really striking findings looking over the electoral data here. I think overall, we're likely to find that Latinos shared some of the distrust in institutions and some of the distrust in the possibilities of politics to make positive change that swept a good deal of the electorate. And I think one of the critical aspects of our time is that there is a great deal of distrust in institutions. There's a lack of confidence in elites, and this is not only of the Trump voters who were not expected to turn out and did in parts of the Rust Belt and elsewhere. I think it extends to other sectors of the electorate. And that's a function, on the one hand, of the kind of polarized politics that we've seen for quite some time. I think it's a function as well of the difficulties that communities are facing a decade after the Great Recession. And I think that it also goes back to the point that Jan was raising about the lived experiences of people in towns, communities all across the country. And I had a very similar response, experience as she did when you talk about being in the Midwest. I drove for about a month through the Midwest and the Rocky Mountains last summer, and I was struck by the degree to which communities seemed to be in crisis, and the degree to which the kind of anger at institutions, anger with elites, seemed so pervasive. And I think that we saw that in this election. I think that distrust of elites, that distrust towards the elites, lack of confidence in institutions, is not strictly a U.S. phenomenon at this point. I think you have to place this election in a comparative context. It's the same. There's a related narrative to be told about Brexit. There's a related narrative to be told about why the Colombian peace process was voted down in a referendum just last month. It's not only that pollsters got all those things wrong. It's that there are dynamics going on in these societies that lead to politics of rejection of elites. And I think that's something that is going to have profound implications for governance and for social cohesion for some time. I think that we also need to place this historically, not just comparatively, but also historically. And I don't think that it is an irresponsible comparison to look at Germany in 1932, where 37% of the population, at a moment of racial racialized nationalism, profound sense of economic dislocation, and profound sense of a lost country, a lost future, led to Hitler's getting 37% of the vote in Germany. And I think here we had a campaign based on an appeal to a lost nation, racialized resentment, and profound sense of economic dislocation and distrust in institutions result in a 47% of the vote for Trump. I don't think that the consequences are going to be the same, but I think the kinds of underlying logics driving unexpected outcomes are there. One last thing about Latinos. I think that there are a set of policy changes that are likely to come about to varying degrees under a Trump administration that will have profound consequences for Latino communities. These range from issues of protection against discrimination of various forms, including policing, and they have to do with access to public services such as healthcare that Latinos have disproportionately gained from in the last several years and may very well fall back. And I think a last factor that is going to have profound implications in Latino communities is highlighted by a study that AU's Metropolitan Policy Center published a month or two ago that comes out of the Washington, D.C. area study that it carried out over the course of this earlier this year. And that study oversampled Latino neighborhoods in Washington, D.C. metro area to get a sense of people's well-being, their sense of membership in their communities, and so on. And what stood out remarkably in those data were the degree to which Latino residents of the D.C. metro area, by strong majorities, emphasized that one of their greatest fears, that one of the greatest problems in their lives was the fear that they or people dear to them would be deported. And that problem of deportability, which I would argue is having very serious public health consequences in Latino communities, very serious problems in terms of the social cohesion of those communities and the integration of those communities into the broader fabric of American life, that is going to grow more severe. And what political implications that has, I don't think we can predict. But it certainly is going to have an impact on the quality of lives for Latinos in the United States.
Eric, thank you very much. Another group that obviously received a lot of attention were women. And so I'm going to turn it over to Jen to talk about that.
Thank you. All of my students are walking out. Whatever. Yeah, class ended. They had to be here. Now they're like, sorry, bye. I want to make a couple of broad points about women, and then I'm going to speak not as long as everybody else because I'm interested in your questions. But after I make a few points about women, I'm then going to just highlight a couple of other facets of the election that I thought were interesting and worth talking about. So first, let me begin with the numbers. This was supposed to be an election cycle, not only where we would see unprecedented attention to female voters, but we also had an opportunity to break a lot of glass ceilings. Well, we didn't break the glass ceiling in terms of a woman being elected president. We did break a glass ceiling. We now have 21 women in the Senate, which is a huge record. We had 20. Calm down, people. But we also saw a net decrease in terms of the number of women in the House. We went down by one. The only other time that has happened was 2010, where we lost three or four. So generally speaking, we held completely steady at this at the congressional level. Now, the upside to the increase in terms of the number of women in the Senate is that we also see quite a bit of diversity. We have four women who were elected. We now have four women in the Senate who are women of color, and that represents a major shift. But in terms of the overall numbers, we're exactly where we were before the election. But that doesn't mean that it's not important to talk about female voters and also to address the implications of what was seen as widespread sexism on the campaign trail. And so let me just focus my remarks here. As Jan mentioned, and as Molly mentioned as well, I believe, partisanship defines who people vote for. And the gender gap is always driven by the party of the candidate, not the sex of the candidate. And if this election cycle doesn't show that on high display, then no election cycle will. Generally speaking, in every presidential election since 1980 and in all congressional elections since 1986, women have been more likely than men to support the Democratic candidate. That doesn't mean that a majority of women always support the Democrat. In 1984, for example, a majority of women went for Mondale, but they did so at lower rates than men. And so what Democrats want to do is exploit this gender gap and make sure that it's as big as it can possibly be. And what Republicans want to do is mitigate that gender gap. And Donald Trump seemed to have no interest in mitigating that gap. If anything, he was basically trying to drive up white male anger and resentment, and he didn't care if he was going to lose female voters along the way. Except he didn't. He didn't lose them. 70% of women said that they did not approve of anything Donald Trump said or did. Yet 89% of Republican women still voted for him. Maybe they held their nose, maybe they're disgusted, but they still cast their ballots for him the same way that they would in any other presidential election for the Republican candidate. Now, we also heard about how this gender gap this time around was going to be larger than we'd ever seen. And it's true, it tied for the largest gender gap. So there was about a 13 percentage point gap. In 2008 and 2012, Barack Obama saw only a 7 and an 11 point gender gap. But if you were to read the commentary, if you were to look at the polls, everybody was predicting a 20 percentage point gender gap. And that was part of Hillary Clinton's path to victory. With a gender gap that was generally the same size as we've seen in the past, and anger among white male voters who were more likely to turn out than they were in the past, that wasn't going to be enough to ensure a Democratic win. Now, the question then becomes, well, did sexism keep Hillary Clinton from winning the presidency? And I guarantee that we are going to see a ton of analyses about this. We're going to see lots of political science articles about this. But I'm willing to go on the record right now and say no. It's not that people were unwilling to vote for a woman for president. There were many, many other factors at stake here. Clinton was an unusual and a unique candidate. Donald Trump was an unusual and a unique candidate. People were angry. They wanted change. Being a woman represented change, but being a woman who was most associated with the establishment didn't really represent much change. That doesn't mean that sexism wasn't incredibly relevant, though. Donald Trump demonstrated that we are a country that is not willing to disqualify a presidential candidate for being an explicit sexist, racist, Islamophobe, and hate monger. Now, that does not mean that those things are not important. That does not mean that the American people endorse what he has said or what he has done. But it means that we were not willing to hold it against him. And because sexism took off the way that it did in this election cycle, and because it didn't cost him the presidency, because that was not enough to disqualify him, there are several implications. Now, you've probably read there are implications about what this is going to mean for a changed tone and rhetoric in society. I think it's too early to tell. The fact of the matter is, most people did not agree with the tone and the discourse that Donald Trump uttered. So I'm not willing to say that we are ready to throw everything out the window and engage in the sexist, racist rhetoric that he's engaged in. But we do know that part of the reason we have a gender gap in political ambition and part of the reason that women are reluctant to run for office in the first place is because they're very reluctant to enter a political terrain that they envision as rife with discrimination and full of sexism. In reality, most races don't look anything like the presidential race we just saw. Since the 1980s, when women run for office, they're just as likely as men to win their races. They're just as able to raise money. In the most recent congressional election cycles, there's nothing to suggest that they receive media coverage that looks any different than men's either. But nobody thinks that's true. Nobody perceives that. I've written a book about it. Nobody believes me. They look at the data. They're like, yeah, well, but, you know, have you seen X? So the reality is this election cycle only further perpetuates a resistance toward this general sense that, look, this is not typical. Donald Trump behaved in a way that's not ordinary. Most female candidates don't experience this kind of sexism. Most female candidates aren't treated this way. What matters is that most potential female candidates and the next generation of candidates look around and say, yeah, I'm totally never going to get into that. And so I worry that not only because of Clinton's loss and what that represents, but because of the way that Donald Trump conducted his campaign, that the kinds of sexism that were seen as completely par for the course are going to trickle down and serve to perpetuate this idea that when women run for office, they can't win their elections. Now, I do want to mention three quick little facts that I think are interesting. The first is that there seems to have been this referendum against the old establishment, right? Clinton lost, Evan Bayh lost his race in Indiana, Russ Feingold lost in Wisconsin, Ted Strickland lost in Ohio. These were all you know, old school Democrats who were seeking their seats again or seeking to return to government. And there seems to have been among the voters this reaction, no, 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 we don't want that. We want new people. The irony, of course, is I don't know if anybody has looked at what the Trump cabinet is going to look like, but it's a snapshot from 1994. So when Newt Gingrich is Secretary of State and Rudy Giuliani is Attorney General, I think that a lot of these Trump voters are going to say, wait, what? The other thing that's interesting is a lot of Trump support was a clear referendum on populism, right? They wanted economic populism. They want change, the kinds of things that Jan and Eric saw when they were traveling across the country. People are frustrated. That's how Trump won Michigan and Wisconsin. That's how he won Pennsylvania. But a lot of these voters also don't agree with Trump on his social policies. And what's tricky here is going to be that enacting the social policies that Trump has promised the conservative base is going to be a lot easier, especially given unified Republican control, than bringing about 4% economic growth in the first 100 days. And so we might see a situation where some voters are a little bit confused as to why it is that the candidate that they elected that was going to bring about this economic reform is instead focusing on these first 100 days on social policy issues. And then the final thing that I'll make here, the final point that I'll make here has to do with this strange bedfellows argument. And Barack Obama's approval ratings right now are quite high. I don't know if anybody's been following this. The highest in his administration. And a lot of those people that support Barack Obama still voted for Donald Trump. So partisanship definitely played a major role here. When you look at how Democrats and you look at how Republicans voted, we see that they voted the partisan line. But those independents actually fell increasingly in the Trump camp. Women, female independents went for Clinton by about a 4-point margin. Male independents went for Trump by double digits. And a lot of those male independents actually approve of the job that Barack Obama is doing. And so Donald Trump inherits a situation and an electorate and a core group of supporters who are expecting the world and who don't agree with him on every single thing. So when we think about a mandate, I think it's very unlikely that he has one. And when we think about his approval ratings and a honeymoon period after that first 100 days, I've been wrong about everything I've said all election cycle, so let me continue down this path. I think voters might be a little bit disappointed.
Thank you, Jen. There's been a lot of discussion of how the media has covered this election. So, Betsy, I'm not asking you to defend the media, but at least speak to it.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I get to be the media, the big bad media representative. it's nice to be here with you all today. I just want to talk a little bit about the question I get asked a lot, which is, did the media create Donald Trump? Or did Trump create the massive media attention that he got? And I think the answer to that is a little bit of both. So I want to talk about that. I want to talk about some of the failures of the media, and then a little bit of implications on what's next in the coverage of a Trump administration in terms of the press. So when we talk about Trump and the media coverage, I think it's helpful to think of this in two phases. So phase one being the primaries, and when he sort of came on the scene. And there's no doubt he came onto the scene as a celebrity himself. You know, a lot of people knew who he was from The Apprentice and Celebrity Apprentice. And so he came on as this novelty candidate that people were interested in following and listening to. Some people in the press didn't take him seriously at all. In fact, I probably think most people didn't. They sort of blew it off. Oh, we've seen him try to run before. He's not serious. He's only doing this to fund his hotels or create his next media network. And so there was this sort of brush off of him. And he did not, when he was at his most accessible during this period, he was not faced with some of these tough questions that you would usually find of a presidential candidate. I remember when I used to be the executive producer of Meet the Press, and I started a series in 2000, Meet the Candidates, and we would have presidential primary candidates come on the show, and Tim Russert, the host of the show, we would grill them for an hour, and it was, you know, AP dubbed it the Russert primary. None of that happened with Donald Trump in that first phase of the primary. The Huffington Post, for example, didn't want to take him seriously. They decided they would only cover him in the entertainment section of the Huffington Post. So Trump was very accessible during that time period. He loves the media at that time. Things have changed. But he would go on to any show that asked him. He would go on cable news, network news, and because he had this leverage about him. People were interested in seeing him. Ratings were through the roof. Now, if you run a cable channel or a network, that's what you like. You want more of it. It's addicting. So he would be on these television shows. He would be allowed to call in, right? Unprecedented. When I produced Meet the Press, we would do a call-in with somebody from a war zone only. and he was allowed to, you know, call into these interview shows, do 10-minute interviews, basically not be challenged very much at all. Why? Well, because when something's working, you want more of it. And so the pressure was, well, we want to have him back, right? So we're going to make this an easy interview, and he'll come back the next time, and our show will be number one again in the ratings that day. And there was just this perpetuation of it. And people often ask, well, why did he get along? Why did he get away with that? Well, he was doing so well, and he knows a thing or two about leverage, right? As a businessman, he could call the terms on any of these media appearances. And you know, I remember, for example, in 2008, when Hillary Clinton was running for president, she was not very accessible to the media. She hated doing television interviews. I tried to have her on the show to do this Meet the Candidates hour grilling that I talked about earlier. No, thank you. Pass. Didn't want to do it. Finally got a call back, and this was been October of 2007. And remember, at this point, she was the front runner. She was the person to beat. She had a lot of leverage. Everybody wanted interviews with her. She didn't want to do them. I remember her press person called me and said, okay, she'll finally come on, but she will only come on for 10 minutes. And you have to share her with all five other Sunday morning shows, so not an exclusive. She wants to do it remote from her home in Chappaqua. And, oh, by the way, you need to pre-tape it on Saturday. Okay, those are four horrible things if you're producing a television show. But, you know, in my position, okay, she's the person that is the front runner. People want to see her. You don't want to see her just on your competitors. So, okay, of course, you can do that. So I can see how this could happen because Trump was calling the shots. He could, if he wanted to do the show from his bathrobe at home, they were going to let him do it and call in. Now, fast forward with Hillary Clinton in that primary in February of 08, when she was down in the polls and needed to come on and do interviews, she came on, did an exclusive interview with us live in South Carolina for an hour. So the tables had turned. She needed the media. So we had this situation where Trump was, you know, his, you know, rallies were carried sort of nonstop. They weren't questioned. I mean, there's a famous quote from the president of CBS saying, it may not be good for America, but it's damn good for CBS. He's money rolling in. This is fun. It's a terrible thing to say, but bring it on, Donald, keep going. And this is the mentality that happened. So this, coupled with him being very accessible, just gave him this boost, and he was able to win the primaries. I think at that point, the media all looked around and said, what's going on here? And then there was this sort of phase two where I think some of the media did a small degree of soul searching and decided, okay, no, he wasn't going to be able to call into the shows anymore. We're not going to run his events without doing some basic fact checking. And he started to get some pretty tough press, mainly print press, investigations into the foundation, you know, investigative pieces into his tax returns, his treatment of women. You all know all of that. So much so that then we see Trump, you know, calling the media as all of a sudden liars and scumbags. Unprecedented for a presidential candidate to be at a rally and pointing to the press and having, you know, people at the rally turn against the press. And he just did a completely 180 on that. He, at a time, banned publications that he didn't agree with, that had written tough stories about him. All of a sudden, they lost their access to him. They were not allowed to be covering his events. But all of that, a negative tension and that hard press that was after him, nothing stuck with the American people for whatever reason. Gallup did a poll. This was before the first debate. And they asked people what their first words would be when they thought about a particular candidate. They're the one word to describe them. For Hillary Clinton, the words were email, lie, Foundation, Scandal, and Pneumonia. This is when the pneumonia story was big in the news. Okay, those are all pretty negative issues. The words for Trump were immigration, Mexico, Obama, campaign, and president. Nothing negative. So none of this was sticking. None of this was sticking to him. Because I think people at the end of the day probably cared more about, you know, their own economic issues, their political party, like Jen talked about, and they were willing to sort of discount all of that. Where I think sort of the networks and the media failed was, again, we mentioned this earlier, this lack of talking about these economic issues and what was impacting people sort of out in the heartland of America. One thing that's happened in the media industry over the last couple of years is the decline of local newspapers. Local papers in places like Michigan, Wisconsin, they don't have the staff that's devoted to covering politics. Most of them have gotten rid of state house reporters that don't even cover the governor anymore. They don't have the money to do a lot of really good reputable polls, because polling is expensive to do a newspaper poll. And so we didn't have the coverage there of a lot of these issues. There was a study done of the network news in the year 2016. This was up until 2 weeks before the election. The amount of time in the network news that was spent on issues, not personality, but issues, in 2016 was only 32 minutes across all three network news associations. That's striking. In 2012, it was 114. Back in 1992, 210 minutes. So we did not have this coverage of some of these significant issues going on. I think social media played a big role, and we can probably talk more about that. People's habits of getting news from Facebook, the issues of Facebook having these kind of fake news stories that go on that are shareable, that fly around. I think that had an impact on people. So, I mean, where do we end up here? It'll be very interesting to see a Trump White House press pool. What's that going to look like? Is there going to be one? Trump has talked about, making changes to the libel laws in terms of making it easier for, people to be able to sue newspapers. The Committee to Protect Journalists president put out a statement a couple weeks ago saying that he represents a threat to press freedom. So I think we're going to see a lot of this friction now in the coming weeks and years, and there's not going to be any of this press honeymoon that's going on. So it'll be interesting to see, does he ban publications from the White House press pool? Is he going to take questions at a news conference? The last couple of months he didn't do any news conferences. Hillary Clinton was criticized for not doing that either. So I think a lot will be, it'll be interesting to see how this media coverage over the next couple of months affects things and how, he's going to have his problems getting along with Congress, but he's also going to have a lot of problems in the media, I think, as well. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Betsy. This has been an interesting year in terms of campaign finance. I think we had certain expectations going into this election, and Sam, I'll let you let us know where we came out.
Thanks, Candy, and thanks to AU for the invitation. I see a couple of former professors in the audience, and I'm struck by the fact that this marks the 20th anniversary of my association with AU in one form or another, and I've always appreciated the fact that AU is willing to provide a home for me to hang my hat academically. Along those lines, despite my day job at CRS, I'm here on personal time, and these are my own remarks. Since I do work at CRS, I don't have opinions on anything, but if I did, the opinions would be my own. So Candy's asked me to speak for just a moment on campaign finance at the federal level in the 2016 cycle. Frankly, given the momentous developments we've seen with all the other topics that we've heard, I don't really think that the major story here is campaign finance. But that doesn't mean that there's not a lot of interesting stuff to talk about, and certainly there will be a continuation of research on money and politics that's really at the intersection of practice and the academy that I think CCPS and SPA try to focus on. So I don't think that I can offer any particularly unique insight here. Frankly, I think that we, regardless of topic, need to remember that for the past couple of years, virtually every panel like this has been wrong. And so I think whatever our topic is, as we have these post hoc panels, a dose of humility is in order. So everything I'm going to mention briefly here is publicly available, and this is just my take, but perhaps I can offer some context for things that I think are potentially noteworthy. So first of all, as of early November, the Center for Responsive Politics, all these data are publicly available, using FEC data, they estimate that the overall cost, meaning spending, in federal elections is going to be just shy of $7 billion, with a B, $6.9 billion. Now, on the one hand, this is the largest figure ever, if it holds, but it's also noteworthy, it seems to me, that when adjusted for inflation, this is almost static with where we were in 2012, and especially considering the extremely competitive Republican primary on the presidential side, frankly, I'm a little bit surprised the number's not higher. And one thing that I think is really important to keep in mind about these aggregate estimates is that they have not a lot to tell us about individual races. And so on the one hand, we see a tremendous amount of money. Certainly on some down ballot races, there was a tremendous amount of money spent. So we've heard very little about congressional races today. But look at something like the Pennsylvania Senate race, where, according to Campaign Finance Institute, reportedly, and these are pre-election numbers, you had $113 million in independent spending alone in that race. On the other hand, in some races, such as a relatively quiet House race, you have literally no outside spending. I mean, I think especially as we focus on things like spending on broadcast in the presidential, which certainly is the major cost factor at the presidential race, it's worth remembering that especially in a lot of House races and even some Senate races, a lot of people really aren't buying broadcast time. In a lot of House races, you're still dealing with things like mail in many cases, which is and digital, which can be comparatively modest. So I think as the story of campaign finance and the election unfolds, it will be interesting to see what are the disparities like in terms of the different type of race and geography. Just to give you a little more overall flavor, another item that does strike me as noteworthy in terms of the presidential, so switching to the fundraising side, let us assume, though, that most campaigns spend all that they raise, or just about. So the Clinton campaign, again, these are pre-election reports, raised almost $500 million. But the Trump campaign raised about half that amount, about $250 million. So. And what's striking about that, to me, there are a couple of things. One, as we heard a moment ago, there's a lot of earned media going on the Trump campaign. Certainly, we'll see a lot more research about that. But also, I think it's noteworthy that what the Trump campaign ends up raising really is not that much more than the Sanders campaign, which is only existing, of course, through the primary. Another thing I would mention here is that don't forget tremendous spending in Senate and House races, but here again, the sources really vary. So of course, we've got large spending in places like Pennsylvania Senate, North Carolina, Missouri, but it really varies in others. We tended to see a lot less coverage of some of those House races, but nonetheless, there was a lot of late fundraising and spending in places like the Loudoun County District, Virginia 10, here in the Virginia suburbs. Another note potentially for researchers going forward. Think about 8 years ago, how many people at forums like this were asking, is it possible that anyone will ever be able to recapture the small donor network that the Obama campaign put together? Well, I think we've seen on both sides this cycle that small donations continue to play a large role, even as fewer candidates, because the program is not so attractive, are participating in the federal program that's designed to incentivize those contributions, which is the Federal Election Campaign Fund. This is the tax checkoff program, which is largely non-existent at this point in terms of participation. Certainly, the effects of Citizens United continue to be felt. A lot of the outside money that we saw is coming from non-party actors such as super PACs, 501c groups. But from a research perspective, I would also note that for political scientists for 50 years now, people have been saying, oh, the next election, that's definitely the death of the parties as institutions. And at least financially, yes, the parties had significant competition from entities like super PACs in particular, but especially on legislative races, the parties are still major players in the aggregate. Now, there are individual races, again, where that's cold comfort if you feel like your race was really determined by a super PAC or a 501c, let's say. So with that, I think I'll stop there and look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Sam. Before we open it up for questions, I'd like to ask if any of the panelists would like to respond to anything that any other panelist has said. No? Okay. We're going to open up for questions. We are recording this for our CCPS website, so if you could wait until somebody comes with a microphone before you ask your question, and then if you could just identify yourself. So who would like to start? We'll open it up. Right here in the front.
My name is Susan Barron. I'm an alum, and I don't know if this is a question. Maybe Eric Hershberg can speak to this, but I know a lot of Puerto Rican, Dominican, and Cuban Americans, second, third generation, and I think one of the biggest mistakes that's being made is these Americans do not have the same issues and agenda as the illegal aliens coming across the border from South America or Mexico, Central America. So I think that was a big mistake. That's just my 2 cents worth. I'm not an expert. But they think it's silly. They shrug on it. I think it's prejudice to lump them all together. It's like saying the Chinese and the Japanese are the same and have the same viewpoints and issues. So that's number one. The other thing is the reason why no one is admitting that they want to vote for Donald Trump is Mr. Hershberg. They don't want to be called a Nazi. I don't think there's any play. I get that economics was one of the reasons why World War II, the Nazis came about, but I really think it's uncalled for and unfair to compare middle America to Nazis. That's why you guys couldn't figure out who people, they don't want to be called. The same thing's going on in Europe right now. If somebody says, I don't want my daughter getting raped, you're a Nazi, you're a racist. Okay, that's just my 2 cents worth. So, I mean, I'm happy to hear anything you have to say in response to that.
There's two things. I think the first thing with regard to the composition of the Latino vote, I think it's widely known that, in fact, the Latino electorate is highly heterogeneous, and the Cuban American vote has typically been more conservative, more Republican, but that's not exclusively the Cuban American vote. There was a lot of discussion this year about the impact of accelerated Puerto Rican migration into Florida. And I have not seen the data around the I-5 corridor, which was particularly strong concentration of Puerto Rican migration, nor have I seen the degree to which that tilted Democratic more than the existing Puerto Rican population, which was one of the hypotheses that was being bandied about. With regard to the comparison with Germany during the 1930s, I mean, it seems to me that combinations of intense nationalism, I think clear strands of racism, and a violent rhetoric are things that we have seen in this country during this election cycle. I don't think that means that everybody who voted for Donald Trump is either racist or violent or what have you. But I think that the appeal that was put forth by the candidate and that was not stepped back from when he was called on it qualifies for us to label it as racist, as hyper-nationalist, and as violent. And I think that we have seen in history societies experiencing profound dislocations with populations that are fearful of those dislocations, are resentful about the kinds of changes that they perceive to be going on around them, and voting as a result in favor of candidates who depart from many of the values that those very voters hold dear.
To your point on the heterogeneity of the Latino or Hispanic population, that's certainly something that scholars of voting behavior know quite well. And people who focus specifically on Hispanic and Latino politics have known this for for decades. And they have, that is especially been difficult to handle as immigration patterns have changed from the different countries. But what happens is oftentimes, I think in the media and in popular discussions, the most highly probably organized and largest Native origin group of Mexican Americans, which have very strong beliefs about a path to citizenship, that is the group that tends to get the most press and that dominates the discussion. I just had a colleague say this morning that if you look at it in a careful and other slices of the way, that there are immigrants in the country who don't like the idea of illegal immigration because they share certain core values, if you will, of the legality, and their preferences on this issue are quite are not as firm and are not as clear. But I think what happens in aggregating votes and running campaigns is we stick at the kind of aggregate level, if you will, and we label a diverse set of individuals as one group. So I think that's certainly the case.
And if I could just add one thing about social desirability and why we might not be telling pollsters what we're thinking, I thought a lot about this, and every case I could come up with prior to this election about social desirability is an attempt for people to seem like they actually are more open and inclusive, right? So people say they're going to vote for Barack Obama, but maybe they're not. People say they're going to vote for Bradley, but maybe they're not. People say they're going to vote for a female candidate, but maybe they're not, right? It's always about trying to seem more open and inclusive than you've actually been. It's always about trying to admit that you want to support the more politically correct view of our society. This is the first election cycle where, if it turns out there was this Trump bump that was masked in the polls, that social desirability worked in the other way, where societal norms actually kept people from admitting that they were willing to cast a ballot for somebody that just sort of defied the face of what we tend to think about as appropriate in politics. And I think that's going to be a question that political scientists, pollsters, pundits, and consultants are going to have to think about moving forward, because in some ways that marks progress and that voters knew that a lot of this rhetoric was not okay. They didn't deem it disqualifying, but how do you go about trying to measure that? We've always thought that people have been more concerned with appealing with reporting the right response. This is the first time I can think of where it seems like the polls went in the other direction.
Is it okay if I make one more comment?
On my way here, I read an article in the Washington Post, which I thought was interesting because it was very tiny with a little picture. And apparently on campus yesterday, or within the past couple of days, there was flag burning. And they didn't say F, they said F, white America. First of all, this is our flag, and I take offense to that, but I think that the kind of saying that white America is aligned with or somehow compared to Nazis somehow makes it okay or creates enough anger to feel we could, they should abuse, it's okay to abuse white America, okay? So I don't know why it's okay for me to not have civil rights because I have blonde hair, blue eyes, and I'm American. But if there was flag burning on campus and saying, F Arab Americans, F Jewish Americans, F Puerto Rican Americans, F anybody other than whites, this wouldn't be happening. So that's more of a comment than a question. And I mean, it just got me going on my way here. I was shocked. And I think that by the university doing nothing, they're doing something.
AU works very hard to include all voices on campus, with also respecting free speech. Yes. In blue.
Yeah, thank you. Because this election proved that the American voting public was looking for a change candidate, the Democratic change candidate was Bernie. And why wasn't he who represented the Democrats that also wanted a change candidate? And my answer to that, and I'm curious what your answers are, is that he was really locked out by the Democratic National Committee and the caucus states and the Democratic elites. Because if we were all looking for a change candidate, he would have made sense for the Democrats.
I guess I'll take a stab at this. The rules in 2016 weren't any different than the rules in 2008. And we had a change candidate who got the nomination then. So I don't buy that argument. I mean, I think the Democratic National Committee may be looking at some of the rules in terms of primaries and caucuses over the next 4 years. But I don't think the structure that the Sanders campaign faced was that much different than what the Obama campaign faced. Yeah, right. Right here? Yeah. There, Taylor, that gentleman in the gray.
Hi, my name is Sebastian. I'm a European exchange student, participant in the Washington Semester Program. And I have more of a question than of a comment. I hope that is still okay. You spoke about the media like not taking Trump too serious the whole time and the polls having it wrong a lot of times. And you spoke also about surprisingly low voter turnout. And my question would be, could you think of the possibility that maybe the media not taking him serious and the polls having like Clinton continuously way above Trump led to this low voter turnout because a lot of Democratic voters or a lot of voters that were not in favor of Trump felt, okay, we don't even need to go to vote because it is that clear. Hillary is an advantage at every poll, so our vote is not needed. It's going to be pretty clear, and there is no necessity of us going to vote and to express our opinion because there is everything settled.
Do we know turnout in the swing states yet, in the battlegrounds?
I don't have it broken, just a national number, but I think your question is a very good one, and I think you saw that reflected in the Clinton campaign closing argument, if you will, that they were very concerned about complacency, that this election was treated as close, but in a lot of ways in the reporting in the final week as a foregone conclusion, and I think you saw a lot of the Clinton surrogates and Hillary Clinton herself, but Michelle Obama and sort of deploying a lot of those surrogates was really about energizing base supporters who might otherwise consider it, not a calculation worth voting given the expectation that she was going to win. So I think you're right that it's a significant concern. I don't know how to measure it, but one of the things that is also a concern on election day and why media outlets don't disclose early numbers or make an agreement not to, although invariably everything leaks, is because you don't want to
disincentivize people from voting when you make the more kind of political science calculation of the cost and benefit of voting. The benefit of having your vote kind of count and be meaningful becomes diminished when there's an expectation that the outcome is, you know, either a foregone conclusion or not going to be close. And so, you know, I think that's a very real dynamic, and I don't know how much of a stake it played in this election, but I certainly think you saw the Clinton campaign being very, very cognizant of that at the end.
I think another thing, though, to consider is the super high negativity ratings that both of these candidates had with people. I mean, the highest ever of two major party nominees. People didn't like either one. And so I think a lot of people just, instead of holding their nose and voting for candidate X, just decided to stay home and not vote for either one of them.
I think it's also going to be interesting to look at the Clinton campaign's ground game. I mean, there's a lot of talk about how it was superior to Mr. Trump's. And yet in the end, he turned out more of those votes in red states and red counties. So. Over here, this gentleman at the end.
I'm Steve Livengood with the U.S. Capitol Historical Society. Does this election compare to 1948 when Harry Truman defeated Thomas Dewey when everyone had predicted Dewey's victory?
I think the only paper to actually publish the wrong headline was Newsweek sent like an early commemorative edition out with Madam President on it. I don't think we had.
Although last week I did more than 40 interviews with papers that were writing their story about electing the first female president. Right. Now, obviously, none of those stories ran, but when the reporters called me, they all jokingly said, I mean, obviously, like, there's a chance this couldn't run, but come on, like, we're just writing this because we know we're going to be slammed after Election Day. So I think, you know, there was this general expectation. The reason I would say that this is a little bit different than 48, though, is the most recent poll leading up to the 48 election was something like 4 weeks before Election Day, right? And so a lot can happen in the last month. Here, the polls were getting it systematically wrong up until 24 hours before Election Day. So if we had to do Truman Dewey over again, I wonder if we would have gotten that wrong. You know, a lot of dynamics had changed in those final 30 days.
But I think the similarity is really just in kind of terms of this important transition period where the country kind of unites and rallies behind the winner, and that's challenging right now because it's so contrary to what expectations were. And so I think, you know, that there is a similarity there in terms of what the challenge is. You know, it's very different in many other respects.
The priority of being in my class and Jen's class.
Well, I might switch to art after this, I don't know. So my name is Sam, I'm a poli-sci major, and going forward, I was just curious what you guys think the role of Breitbart and Steve Bannon and the alt-right is gonna be in the American conservative movement.
So I'll do the,
non-media person response, that I think that we, of course, have had dramatic changes in the media business, and I think the lack of resources that real news organizations have has killed us. And we don't have consistent and good reporting, and it becomes a motivated media content. Having said that, even on the traditional and well-respected media that I think have been hit over the head a little bit too much this campaign season. Despite that, that news product has always been a cooperation between reporters and candidates. And so the power and the access goes both ways. I can't imagine that. So I think in part Trump will have to calculate the advantages and disadvantages, the costs and benefits of being too holden to Breitbart and the other alt-right outlets. They will continue to thrive in the very places, I would think, that elected Trump. But it's I mourn for that loss of a broad set of diverse groups of news outlets that have the reporting ability?
I disagree respectfully. I think we're doomed. And let me just explain why. We have fragmentation of the media now where you can watch anything that you want to watch and see anything that you want to see and write and omit anything that doesn't comport with your worldview immediately. And with the death of local news and the death of local newspapers, we've also created a situation where people that are not even that interested in news have a really, really easy time not getting access to any. You don't even happen upon news on your way through the sports section anymore because your local newspaper doesn't exist, or it's three pages, right? So what this means is that I think the Trump campaign and now the Trump presidency and the people that he surrounds himself with and the conservative movement have an increased incentive to give these kinds of people not only additional access, but also to rely on them more heavily because there's no disincentive to doing that. The people that are opposed to Trump are going to continue to watch MSNBC and mourn with Rachel Maddow for the next 4 years. And the people that support Trump are going to continue to support those kinds of outlets. And the people who are somewhere in the middle are going to continue to just sort of do what they've been doing. The danger, I think, this time around is that this media environment worked for Donald Trump. And so when you know that something is working for you, there's no reason to work to go in an opposite direction. There's no reason to be more inclusive, or there's no reason to limit their access. These media outlets and the fact that he actually brought them into his campaign as operatives suggest that this is a package that resonated with 50% plus one of the population when you look at where they live. So I just don't think that there's going to be any reason to change course. I don't think he's going to exclude mainstream outlets from the press corps because that just sort of flies in the face of what we expect of a president. And there is a difference between being president and being a presidential candidate. But I tend to think it's going to be bad.
We don't disagree as much as you might suggest on some of those points. I think certainly he does have those alternative media, and they will make his case and make the red even redder, right? But if he is the deal maker, if he has any ambition to get anything done, he needs more than Breitbart. And that doesn't mean that the folks who watch MSNBC or the folks who only watch or pay attention to Breitbart or Fox, I realize they are not going to change their behavior, and maybe the news product won't change. But I think to get something done, he will require some broader access to the media.
I mean, I agree with what Jen was saying about what I call the choose-your-own-news adventure, where you can literally go in and follow the certain people that you like and agree with on Facebook, and there's this, you live in your own news bubble. And people, if you know, they see something out of their bubble that they just completely discount it and they don't believe it. It's like when the stock market is bad, you don't necessarily want to go on every day and see what's going on. You want only the good news, and so you only want your news that reinforces your own political opinion. And then, you know, I think something else to keep in mind is historically when we've seen these news outlets that pop up on one side or the other, historically, they do better and have a bigger megaphone and bigger following when they're talking about the opposition. So I'm not sure if Breitbart, with a Trump presidency, would be as relevant or as loud as Breitbart would have been in a Hillary Clinton presidency.
Let me go back here. Woman in black, right there.
So my question was, in the next couple weeks, Donald Trump is going to be going on trial for allegedly raping a 13-year-old in 1994. So during the election and the campaign, it was not picked up as much to become as big of a scandal as like the emails. So I was wondering, why was that not kind of reported on as much by the media? And what would happen if he were convicted on those charges?
President Pence, I mean,
which I think is a disservice done, I think, to the American people during this election was because we spent so much time focusing on the candidates, their personalities, their scandals. We spent virtually no time on the vice presidential candidates and their records and what they stand for and what they support. This was the vice presidential debate was seen as completely boring and not particularly meaningful. And Mike Pence is somebody who I think if became president of the United States, the American people might disagree with a little bit on, you know, some of his policies and some of the preferences that he's put forward in his other elected capacities. So, you know, I think that if Trump is convicted, or there's also the Trump University case, I mean, I think it's unlikely that we'll see something like that happen. But if in the next month or so, you know, those cases don't work in Trump's way, I think the media might step back and realize that maybe they didn't scrutinize or at least provide the kind of information about Kane and Pence that is typically conveyed over the course of an election. Now, vice presidential candidates don't sway elections, but we usually know a little more about them than what we've learned this time around. They usually get a little bit more attention.
In the back? Yeah.
So since the election, there's been a few news articles coming out about the possibility of faithless electors on December 19th when the Electoral College votes. So maybe pending the results of the trial, and who knows, can you guys talk a little bit to the possibility of that happening?
It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, that'll be a fun story that everybody is trying to keep up with. I just saw on my Facebook feed, like, 25 people just posted the way Hillary could still become president. Like, it's just, but 4 years from now, you get another shot. I don't think there are going to be faithless electors.
We're certainly not enough to turn the election. Yes, this gentleman's waiting for a while. Right here. There, Moran's coming.
Hi, Steve Caffin. I work at USAID audit. I do auditing. Donald Trump didn't win the election. Hillary Clinton lost it. I met her for the first time 20 years ago when I was a Peace Corps volunteer in Russia, and she came with her husband in 1996. She has this wonderfully warm and sensitive and modulating voice and style, very human with people, that rarely did we see either informally or formally on television. I met her again 7 years later in Kenya. I was responsible for the auditing at the Peace Corps, and she recognized me at a table and walked up, and she had that engaging manner. We never saw it. And it's shocking to me because her husband was the master at this. I feel your pain. The first sentence was always recognition of the particular pain and how he was going to solve it. There was a lack of connection, and I think that hurt her. Something else about the Latino vote, it was clear why it happened. It's not confusing. Above all else, one of the most, perhaps the most important ethic for Latinos, principally Latino families, is the work ethic. And there's no person who exemplifies the work 24 hours a day, 365 days a year ethic as Donald Trump does. And that may not have been taken into account in the polls. And I have one just Comey. The second Comey letter was not a detriment. It was a gift. It was a gift to her. She had the opportunity to demonstrate why she was the best qualified person, going back to the 3 a.m. telephone call. Here was a problem. She was going to take control over trying to identify what was going on and solving it. And the reaction was totally different, and unfortunately, those were the consequences. And I do have a question relating to media, which is going to be critical ongoing. The media has to determine whether it's going to be a C-SPAN, or whether it's going to take control over its presentation. Unfortunately, Tim Russert in 2000 began this, when, if you recall, every day he would remind us how many days it's been without a president, pushing things when he shouldn't have pushed it. the talk shows on Sunday seem to be, at this point, pretty much scripted. You know who's going to appear. You know what they're going to say. And I don't know whether the networks are going to do some soul-searching if necessary, totally reconstruct how they wish to present the news. Let's pull together a bunch of things a lot of you have said. You may have a comment on this.
I mean, I agree with you on the network front, which is why I'm at American University now and not at a television network, because those sort of things bothered me. I hope there is some sort of soul searching. And, you know, I mentioned the lack of attention on issues earlier that I think has been significant. And there is this, kind of ratings pressure coverage do things in a certain way and not spend time on, you know, boring issues because people don't care. So I hope it changes, but I don't see a lot of evidence that that would happen, fortunately.
I'll just make a comment about one of your first observations about the connection issue that Hillary Clinton struggled with. We certainly saw that in a lot of the qualitative research that we did when we asked voters about their impressions of her. They're very confident in her experience, her qualifications, her decision making, but the warmth and the kind of emotional connection. She acknowledged that during the campaign that didn't come easily for her in a group setting. That it came much more easily to her husband, and that it didn't come very easily to her. She had to challenge herself. I think the campaign tried very much to put her in settings where she was able to do that more organically and naturally. And when she did, I think it was very successful. I think there weren't enough examples of that. And I think, like I said, to her own acknowledgement, that is a hard thing for her. The one thing I guess I would, and I don't know the answer to this question, but I think is significant to at least look at is, I always felt in doing qualitative research, my question that I would never quite get to answer is the expectation about an emotional connection the same for a male candidate as it is for a female candidate? And so her absolutely clearing the bar in terms of experience, qualification, know-how, intellect was very, very clear. And I feel as though the kind of expectation that you also have to emotionally understand her, have her be accessible to you, is something that we don't expect in the same way of male candidates. It may be of Hillary Clinton in particular because she's been around for so long and we still don't know her, and that is a frustration. So I think there's a lot of things going on there, but I think it still is part of the difference of how we deal with female candidates and how we deal with male candidates.
I thought also we got a sense of her. I mean, to me, watching her concession speech was probably the best speech that she's given, because you did give a sense of her as a real human and a person who was suffering and hurting, and that came through in her remarks.
And you saw yesterday. That in New Hampshire in 2008,
yes.
When she, had more of a kind of emotional moment in
right.
the wake of her disappointment, and voters said, oh, that was what we were waiting to see all primary season.
Right.
And I do think that whether it's a double standard or a mixed standard, I do think that there is a gender dynamic to that piece of it.
Right here. Hi, my name is Hendrik. I'm a German exchange student. And in Germany, third party is very important in every election. So how important is the third party in the U.S.? Because even like 3 or 4% in every state could cost Hillary the state. So how important is that?
So I don't think it actually mattered. I mean, there was a lot of attention on election night as to, oh my gosh, look, the total number of votes cast for Stein and Johnson combined exceeded the Trump-Clinton margin. But based on the exit polls, there's nothing to suggest that those voters would have systematically gone for Clinton. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if they would have stayed home. I don't know if they would have broken between Clinton and Trump. But I don't think this is a situation like it was in 2000, where the butterfly ballot and Buchanan's name being there actually cost Gore the presidency.
I just wanted to ask about the response to the election. So I've seen differing opinions on like a comparison to the election of 2000 in terms of what we're seeing from Democrats and people who are upset with the election result. We've seen demonstrations and protests, et cetera. You can categorize it as hate speech, but the reality is that it's still protected by the First Amendment. So have we seen this in modern American history? Is the election of 2000 a reasonable comparison? And if not, is there an election that we could compare the aftermath to?
Well, I think one thing is it's a little soon. I mean, we're only 36 hours away, maybe not even that, from knowing what the outcome of the election was. I think it's reasonable for people, when their candidate loses, to be disappointed. You know, if you go back to 1968, when McGovern lost, the Vietnam War was an important issue, particularly for young people. But what we saw then, and I think what we saw in 1980 when Reagan won, I think there's going to be a discussion within both political parties about where they're going forward and how they're going forward. I remember talking to a former student in 1980, and he was like going into the woods, and coming out of the woods, and we figure out a way as a country to move forward and figure out a way I'm cautiously optimistic, particularly in the way that leaders on both sides have spoken about a President-elect Trump and his administration.
I think that's right too, but I would add that what is a little bit different this time is, so I've been teaching this, I've been teaching campaigns and elections since 2012, and so this is the fifth presidential election, and this is the first time that I've gotten a barrage of emails from various administrators and consultants explaining how to deal with your classes the day after. I don't know that means that there's going to be rioting or higher levels of violence or anything like that, but I do think that the shell-shocked nature, especially among young people, of the outcome is something that's a little bit unanticipated and new to all of us.
And I think it goes to the fact that, as you've pointed out and the panels have pointed out, the expectation of the outcome was very different than the actual outcome. So people have had to readjust their mindsets in a way that doesn't always happen. Taylor's right behind you. There you go.
I'm Bob Heiss. Not surprisingly, we didn't hear the major candidates talk about the role of technology in changing the manufacturing workplace and probably destroying jobs. We also didn't hear about the increased supply of natural gas from fracking and how that's affected the coal industry. I wasn't surprised about that, but the media did not raise those points with the candidates to join the issue, and those are tough questions. Why not?
Because the media are out to make some money. and that's nothing new or different. In fact, it's an even stronger imperative today, as Betsy's comments suggest. Kind of for a political scientist, classic study of media coverage of elections is Tom Patterson's book on the 1972 presidential election, and it was, the mass media election was the election about the horse race, and he looked at newspapers and TV and said, wow, most of the coverage is about the game and the strategy and the horse race, and we didn't cover it back then. Given the changes in the news media, I don't know how you create that incentive or that alternative. So just to note that this isn't, there isn't a nostalgia back to the good old days that holds up especially well.
And we do have this, propensity to kind of cover the shiny metal object of whatever it is. And I think in this case, we had, two candidates with big personalities, a lot of other issues going on, issues related more to personality than what we would normally think of as, policy issues that I just think drowned out everything else, and people's interest level and people that make decisions of what goes on television and what goes in the newspaper. There was just all of these shiny metal objects that kind of absorbed all the attention.
I thought it was also ironic in that the energy question that was posed during the debate was in the town hall, by one of the voters who was called upon at the end. I thought actually some of the more substantive questions, just like you described, asking the candidates to explain their differences or their distinctions in kind of very clear terms that voters can understand, I thought a lot of those were actually posed in that town hall between, you know, Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act, and on renewables and on energy and on replacing manufacturing jobs. Those questions came out of the town hall debate.
I think that the concern that you raise about technological transformation and what impact that's having in the worlds of work that discussion didn't happen because it's a complicated discussion, and the ways from the public policy responses are neither straightforward nor likely to be able to deliver what people want, and therefore the discussion becomes one about trade, and it is a discussion that is also not particularly well informed, but that is trying to appeal to people's sense of unease and displacement. And the answer becomes we're going to get rid of NAFTA, or that we're not going to go for TPP. I mean, Clinton abandoned the TPP as a way of trying to demonstrate sensitivity to that set of concerns, and when actually probably the only reasonable answer would have been some combination of TTP and programs of technological innovation.
Hi, my name is Sven. I'm in the Washington Semester Program as well, and I'm from Germany. Mr. Hershberg, you made the comparison to the situation in Germany in the 1930s. However, you said that the consequences will not be the same. So I would be interested in, if you're brave enough, what predictions you would make, what consequences a Trump presidency will have, and where you see the U.S. in 4 years from now.
I can't venture a comprehensive answer to that question. I think in terms of where the U.S. is in 4 years from now, something we haven't talked about on the panel, but that I think a number of the panelists would have valuable perspectives on, is the way in which both parties are going to evolve over the course of the next 4 years. I think that there's going to be quite a bit of conflict in both parties about where they go moving forward. And how those conflicts evolve or resolve will have a lot to do with what the country looks like 4 years from now. I think that the Trump administration is going to, I believe, exacerbate racial tensions in the country that I think are very concerning. I think that it's quite clear that in some parts of the world, the ability of the United States to exercise influence and to express its preferences in ways that are treated as worthy of consideration is going to diminish. In the part of the world that I work in Latin America, there is no question whatsoever that the quality of relations with the United States is going to be significantly eroded, in some places more than others. But the responses already are, I think, quite telling. And I think that the ability of the United States to manage complex problems, both domestically and in the world arena, will be hampered to the extent that a President Trump acts in ways that are similar to the ways in which he acted as a candidate.
In the back. Taylor, all the way back.
Hello, my name is Demi. I'm an exchange student from Germany in the Washington Semester Program. I'm interested what role foreign policy played in these elections, and especially to what extent Donald Trump's new isolationist foreign policy view made him win the elections. For example, his proposal to withdraw from NATO or to disengage the United States in the Middle East.
I'll just say from a public opinion perspective that when asked to compare the candidates on various policy areas and attributes, that Clinton always had a lead decisively on ability to handle foreign policy. Unfortunately, that wasn't what this election was about. It was about the economy. And Trump narrowly outdistanced her on that by 3 or 4 points in the exit polls in terms of which candidate was better to handle the economy. I just don't think there's not a lot of precedent for foreign policy dominating much. There is a segment of voters to whom that's very important and they pay a lot of attention, but broadly it's not an issue that has a lot of traction with the electorate in a presidential year outside of outside of war, outside of a major national security issue.
That's right, and what I would add is the kinds of things that he said about foreign policy bolstered his credentials to improve the U.S. economy, right? So the kinds of, we're going to have the best deals, we're going to only have good trade, we're going to, you know, make America great again, was something that he was talking about. Those kinds of, that mantra wasn't only about the economy, it was also about, you know, we're going to, it's not fair that other countries aren't paying their fair share in NATO, right? So it wasn't that people were voting based on their foreign policy concerns, but the kinds of things he was saying about foreign policy were consistent with his narrative about how to improve the U.S. economy. And I think that's part of the reason that Clinton was able to maintain an edge on foreign policy as we traditionally think about it. But Trump wasn't hurt by the kinds of things that he said in the way that, for example, in 2004, George Bush was. You know, he was reelected, but in part, he was held accountable for the kinds of relationships that he had ruined between getting elected in 2000 and in 2004. And he was also very vague on a lot of foreign policy specifics. I mean, time and time again, he was asked about, you know, what he would do in the war on terrorism. ISIS, I'm not going to forecast right now what I'm doing. I'm not going to give away my plan. Or, you know, and so we never got, you know, the 5-point plan from him on a lot of different issues.
I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions. So right here and then.
It's kind of a follow-up from my third-party question, and Mr. Hershberg said that the parties now have to somehow renew themselves. So when nobody really, or many people did not like Hillary and Donald, is there a chance now for third party? Or will it just be the same as always?
There's no chance, no. We don't have third parties here. What I would say is, I think a Donald Trump law, I mean, like, that's it. It's virtually impossible, right? It's impossible to be an outsider in the system, the way the campaign finance system works, the way that you get on ballots in other states, the way that you go about actually building a coalition. Partisanship now in the United States is actually seen as a social identity, the same way that race or sex or region of the country that you live in is. So it's not the same as where you grow up in a place where there are lots of different parties and you have choices. Like, political scientists say party ID is learned at mommy's knee. And it pretty much is, right? Most of the time, you might sometimes vote for a different party in one particular election, but that social identity, you know, really shapes who you are as a person. One other thing I would add, though, is that I think there was a greater likelihood of there being a Republican autopsy and a real reshaping of the party if Trump would have lost. Mm-hmm. If anybody saw Paul Ryan's speech yesterday, it made me want to vomit. He's like, and he's actually right. Like, everybody was talking all along about how these Republican candidates really had to distance themselves from Trump. Nobody was expecting Trump coattails, but there were Trump coattails, right? Like, the Republicans now actually do owe Trump some degree of credit for getting them reelected, which makes it a lot more difficult for them to fight against him. And they have unified government. There's no check in terms of the Senate. So, you know, if they want to get stuff done, they actually have an opportunity right now to cooperate and to cohere behind an agenda, which suggests that it's probably going to be a little bit less likely that there's going to be the kind of infighting that we expected.
I think the last question is going to go to Miranda, right here.
So I guess Professor Lawless kind of touched about it a little bit. With the Republican Party completely in control, I guess my question was going to be, we saw a lot of establishment Republicans sort of back lashing out at Trump towards the end. Do you think they're actually going to support the policies that he's campaigned on, and if they're actually going to support him on things that even they've spoken about throughout the campaign trail? And with that being said as well, what do you think the Democratic Party needs to do at this point in order to mobilize voters, especially for midterm elections coming up?
As far as the first part is concerned, the Republicans don't actually disagree with him on that many policy views. I think the Republicans are like, okay, great, now we have a different policy on trade. Right? But when you look at everything else, there's actually quite a bit of consistency. The Republicans that were distancing themselves from him were distancing themselves because of his tone, his rhetoric, his discourse, and his indiscretions, not because the bills that he wants them to introduce fly in the face of what the GOP generally stands for. So I don't think there's going to be that much of a problem there. They're going to continue to distance themselves, I think, if he acts as President Trump the way that he did as candidate Trump. But that was never a policy problem.
And I think that's... Go ahead.
No, just I agree with that, but I would add one caveat, which is that on foreign policy, there are some real profound differences between what Trump articulated as his view of the world and of the United States' role in the world and that of the Republican establishment since the Second World War. And one of the reasons that you had dozens of the leading national security intellectuals and policy planners associated with Republican administrations from the Reagan era on come out against Trump, not necessarily in favor of Clinton, but denounce Trump as a threat to U.S. national security and to the world order, was because of the degree to which his positions, whether with regard to Russia, with regard to the relationship with China, with regard to proliferation of nuclear weapons, with regard to the Middle East, were seen as radically outside the mainstream of American foreign policy thinking.
And with respect to the midterms, I think on the Democratic Party side, I think they're going to be looking 4 years down the road rather than two. It's unlikely that they would take back the House in 18, and the makeup of Democrat and Republican candidates really disfavors them in 2018. They've got, I think, 23 seats they've got to defend. So it doesn't look good for them in the short term. I think they'll be looking at 2020 and who they might think about as candidates then. I think that we're about out of time.